नमस्कार, दिस इज उमाचरण पति, डेप्यूटी रजिस्ट्रार ऑफ गंगाधर मेहर यूनिवर्सिटी. आई वेलकम ऑल ऑफ यू टू दिस थर्ड लेक्चर ऑफ द वेबिनार सीरीज बीइंग ऑर्गेनाइज्ड बाय द स्कूल ऑफ हिस्ट्री. एंड वी आर थैंकफुल टू ऑल ऑफ यू फॉर ज्वाइनिंग विद अस. वी हैव विद अस आवर ऑनरेबल वाइस चांसलर प्रोफेसर एन नागराजू सर. वी आर ऑन द वे टू भुवनेश्वर फॉर ए ऑफिशियल मीटिंग एंड वी आर नियर बोइंडा नाउ. सो वी आर थैंकफुल टू ऑल ऑफ यू. And I welcome on behalf of the GM University family, Professor Chandi Prasad Nanda sir. Sir is a noted academic and a known person in Odisha as well as at the national level. We are thankful to you, for you sir, for honoring the invitation of our esteemed Vice Chancellor and sparing your valuable time for our teachers, students and research scholars. We are thankful to all our members of the syndicate, academic council, faculties of GM University, all heads of the departments, invited guests, my friends, some of my friends from media, and all the students.
Yes, sir. So there is some
let me take this opportunity to all the deans, our teaching and non-teaching. So thank you very much for joining with us. Now I request our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor N. Nagaraju, sir, for opening remarks. Sir.
Thank you, Dr. Pati. Dr. Mishra, our other officers, faculty members, and students, I join all of you in welcoming Professor Chandi Prasad Nanda for today's webinar. I think this is the third in the series on vernacular reasons and belongingness, and the topic, provincializing the world of Desi, it promises to be a very, very interesting topic because you have two words here which to me, as from the cultural studies point of view, is interesting, the way the word Desi is deployed, and second, provincialization. On top of that, you have the history as it is retold by Odisha as retold by its history. Probably Professor Nanda has some historiographical aspects to add to this talk, and I think other than that, probably I wouldn't be able to make much sense of the topic as of now, but it's quite interesting, and part of the growing interest in the research and other related studies of Odisha history. I look forward to the talk. And welcome again, Professor Nanda, to our midst for this talk. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. On behalf of the GM University, a special note of appreciation for the School of History being led by Dr. faculty members, students, research scholars for organizing. Now I request our webinar lecture. Dr. Mishra,
yes.
Please carry
yes.
forward because we are on the way. There is possibility of
Thank you.
The network problem. So please conduct the proceedings of this webinar.
Thank you, esteemed Vice Chancellor Professor N. Nagarajuji, esteemed speaker Professor Chandi Prasanandaji, distinguished participants, which include also the members of Central Board of Direct Access, Sri Prasanna Das Ji, Professor Nivedita Mahanti, distinguished many other participants from across the country and the state. Welcome to this third lecture in the webinar series. I am delighted to share the title of the today's presentation, which seems to be very provocative to me. And this lecture will be delivered by Professor Chandi Prasanandaji. And there are many, as our Vice Chancellor has said, there are many, many provocative ideas embedded in this title. The title of the presentation is Reprovincializing the World of Desi Rather Than Vernacular. Odisha as retold by history too. There is another history that we are talking of. Then comma subaltern past and trans memorations, the otherizations. Therefore, there is a disenchantment with the way we have configured the present provinces. And there is a need to reprovincialize. And the way we have configured the present region, the present provinces, in the present modern historical narrative, according to Professor Nanda, is deeply problematic. And therefore, we need to bring in Desi, which has not been there, the vernacular, which has not been there in this narrative or in this configuration of provinces, which has come up in the last, you know, last decade of 19th century, early decade of 20th century and 20th century. Therefore, there is a disenchantment with modern historical writing from the title, which includes the way region has been historicized. Historicizations of 150 years, largely based on European notion of history, has glossed over many other accounts of past, such as that of Madala Panji, Kataka Raja Vansavali, and many other narratives, which are, there, for example, Burunji traditions of Assam. These accounts believe in dharmic explanations of reality rather than rational contingencies. It talks of heterogeneous times rather than homogeneous times of human beings. And therefore, there is a need to rethink of our history, the way our history has been written, and the way our provinces has been reconfigured. And in this, when we bring in Desi turn, there is also the aspect of otherness, the otherization, which has largely been erased in the existing writing. With this background, let me also read out the abstract which has been sent by Professor Nanda to amplify his title. Quote, focusing on an inaugural moment of project of spatiality in terms of an imagination of a geocultural space, as articulated in 15th century Odia Mahabharata, the present lecture seeks to think through the evolving conceptions of folk, local, popular, subaltern, vernacular in both pre as well as post-colonial registered Odisha. In problematizing the W questions of why, when, and how of this vernacular, it tends to illustrate how vernacular signals came to terms with transmemorization, that as a discursive practice. This could consist in heeding the call of otherness, which has largely been, you know, ignored or conventionalized in the narrative of present day history, which remains entangled between disparate experiences, knowing languages, cultures, and geography, drawing on these erasure of otherness, which he calls as transmemorations. The presentation argue or calls to attention the limit of every historical translations with which we have been engaged in the over last 150 years, and its exclusions fabricated through unspoken claims of otherness. This is very important to emphasize upon. The way otherness has been conventionalized in the existing narrative, including the writing of, you know, German historical research project work. Professor Nanda is in Department of History of Ravensa University, and he has been a distinguished academic of the nations, as Dr. Pati told. He has been the president of Modern Indian History Sections of Indian History Congress in 2015. He has been part of German research project too, and contributed scholarly article one on Gangapur state and the other on Keunjar. His works reflects his inherent restlessness with certitudes of categories, starting with popular resistance and polities in the JNU historiography mold of the nationalist period. He has gone beyond this narrative to work on health, body, polity in colonial times, on local history, that is on Kudimbi Mahanta, and now his book on fabric of time and histories is about to be released. His books include, as I told you, Fabric of Times and Histories, co-authored with Priti Sacharya, Rethinking Local History, which is a work on local history of Kudumbi community of Keunjhar, Mayurbhanj area, Vocalizing Silence, which was published in 2008, which is the narrative spun around JNU School of Historiography, published by Sage Publications in 2008, a book on Hare Krishna Mata. He has been awarded with many distinctions, which include LEAP program sponsored by MHRD in Harvard University, a recipient of Aarhus University Global Research Grant, Erasmus Fellowship in 2015, and Charles Wallace Fellowship twice in 1999-2007. He has been a visiting professor to University of Jadavpur, University of Aarhus in Denmark, and University of Chicago in 2019. And we are extremely privileged to have him today and hear his provocative ideas, and with the expectation that this will open up new vistas of research, new lines of research which we need to think of and proceed. Thank you so much. I invite Professor Nanda to give his lecture, and which will be followed by Q session. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Uma, for this kind words, you know, a generous introduction. And also I take this opportunity to specially thank profusely the esteemed Vice Chancellor of GMU, Professor N. Nagaraju, and all other members who are part of this whole idea of, you know, brainstorming, which perhaps one of those major idea that you have picked up, and thanks to the department itself. Before I start, I also like to thank the participants who have been here to share their comments and, you know, perspectives as they, you know, tend to converse with the kind of lecture that I'm going to draw on in the next couple of minutes. So I would really look forward to some of these comments. But before that, can I just request you, if you allow me, can I share my PowerPoint a bit? It's a long PowerPoint, but if I can just skip through some of this point. Can I do that? Thank you again. So as you rightly said, and also initial comments which came from esteemed Vice Chancellor, saying that something to do with historiographic perspectives, and also needs to be critically looked from the lens of culture studies, that makes the point. Yes, I understand that I have put in this title in full awareness of the fact that these are deeply contested categories that I've been trying to propose. But at the same time, I think that to think through an idea like this when you are brainstorming on a question like region, locality, and that the way your concept note suggests, demands a kind of interrogation of certain ideas that with which we have been so familiar. So when I say reprovincializing, I mean, this is a question I also have been thinking for a long time. When I say reprovincializing the world of Desi, I know that the way our political modernity has defined our regions and our, the nation, the idea of nation, the idea of regions, the way it has been defined through some of the concepts of political modernity, are drawn from a very robust intellectual tradition of Europe. And I take this imaginary figure into mind, and I try to suggest that this needs to be interrogated. And while to do this, maybe we need some kind of, you know, frameworks which could be very different from the ones that we have been with which we have been working so far. So the basic structure of this presentation would go like this, that I'm trying to use these concepts in certain ways by illustrating some of the materials from Odisan history and culture. And it's a time range is, of course, 500, 600 years, starting from 15th century, where I take, Sarala Mahabharat, the first literary text, Odia literary text, which tries to talk about a geo-cultural region. As you know, that Sarala Das wrote that famous text, which was more or less a kind of reconceptualized ideas of the original Mahabharat. And how did he, this to me inaugurates, as it has been acknowledged widely, that it's an inaugural moment of vernacularization. But before that, we have to also discuss what exactly vernacular could mean. Of course, when we see this inaugural moment and as it passes through, and from there, I look at this world of, Sarala Mahabharat inaugurates a project of spatiality, a kind of geocultural space along with a socio-textual community, which is called into being, or which is summoned into a kind of entity. From there, as we move on, we see that in 16th, 17th century, there is another kind of temple chronicle that we encounter in terms of Madala Panji. And this, the history of Madala Panji, as one of those very famous historians who have already done immensely and whose seminal contribution to the understanding of Odisha history and culture has been seminal, is Professor Kulke, who says that Madala Panji is to be taken seriously. And particularly, he tries to also point to a very interesting text which was written in 1920, called Kataka Rajavansawali. And he sees this as the colonial biography of a, Sanskrit text. And by looking at the kind of history which is associated with the text, Kataka Rajavansawali, I try to suggest that the vernacular, which pronounced it itself right since 16th century, right since 15th century, from Sarala Mahabharat, the way it developed and the way it tried to express itself. And we see a particular moment in 19th century when it is hounded out of the domain of history, and by calling it as, historical. And I also bring in this comment of a very famous, epigraphist, colonial epigraphist J. Split, who says that these kind of materials, like these Vanshavalis or the, temple chronicles, are not to be taken seriously. And no history can be written on the basis of these writings. So that colonial censure went a long way in at least hounding out these voices. So vernacular somewhere remained kept up. Very interestingly, as I'll try to argue, I'll come back to this question again by saying that if a text like Kataka Rajavansawali was written in 1820, till about 1978 and 1980s, this could not come to public gaze because of this colonial censure. And also entangled with this kind of understanding was the kind of opinion which was shared by the nationalist historians of the region. Some of them are very well known, and they tended to think that this is a kind of text which cannot be very seriously relied upon. And from there, I want to discuss how in the whole of 19th and 20th century, vernacular kept coming into a kind of conversation with the imperious empire of history, with the authorized convention of historical narrative in certain ways. And it tried to mock, it tried to ridicule the whole structure of narration which is embedded in the historical discursive practices. And so when I say that when we try to understand Desi, we need to understand its career from 15th century onwards to 20th century, from both in the pre-colonial and post-colonial registers. And wherein I try to, in that last section, I try to show that the, you know, legendary accounts of the princely states, you know, Odisha is, was one of those provinces where we had 26 princely states. So the dynastic accounts, the genealogical accounts of these states, and the accounts which narrates the life world of the Thakuranis, their origin, these accounts which were fascinatingly, which fascinatingly talk about the kind of culture of a sub-region, of a locality, was never taken into account. And culminating with some of these writings where we also kept seeing that subaltern voices, the vernacular voices, were sought to be, you know, excluded from historical narratives. So coming back to these points more systematically, what I'll try to do is to show you, I mean, I'll try to basically discuss what could vernacular ways of being could mean. As you know that in the first millennium, Sanskrit had its dominance. And in the second millennium, there was a very systematic attempt on the part of the literature or the poets, people who were involved in creative activities, tried to consciously choose a kind of language. And in a way, they tried to supplant the translocal codes within which Sanskrit existed, and tried to question this. And instead of preferring Sanskrit as a global language, they thought of speaking locally. So instead of global to local, which came in the first half of second millennium, say about till 15th, 16th century, we see whether it is in Maharashtra, or it is in Gujarat, or it is in South, or in Odisha, we see that there is a proliferation of literary text which try to talk about their own regions. And it is in this context that we see Sarala Mahabharat makes a lot of sense. So what I'm trying to highlight, that is we need to study the history of choices, which is very important, because these choices were available to a kind of society at a particular point. And when we are being confronted with an idea like, you know, homogenization or a kind of culture recent in our contemporary times, whether it is liberalization, globalization, or Americanization, and then how do we figure ourselves or how do we try to, you know, make sense of this idea of our own region, our own locality, our own voices, and how do we do that? If we and the point that I'm trying to also highlight, that bringing in a kind of Heideggerian insight into conversation instead of Marx, who basically, you know, popularized this idea of history one, where you know, capital history one is the one where histories remain posited by capital, or history one is the master narrative. But history two basically is the kind of domain where what we see that histories that do not belong to capital's life process. And if you look at the antecedents of capital, there is a, you know, large amount of past that capital encounters. But all these past do not work onto the logical, logically work onto the definition of the life process of the capital. So in that sense, there are certain past which do not, you know, belong to the capital's life process. And these are the past which I bracket it as history twos. So when we try to study the history of choices, this question of, you know, bringing in history too is important. And as you can very clearly understand that the second millennium was basically characterized by a kind of very serious transformation in the domain of cultural practices, identity formations, and political order, with critical and enduring consequences. And it is in this context that some of the universalistic order formations and practices of the preceding millennium, that the first millennium, came to be supplemented, supplanted, and replaced by its localized forms. And this is where we come, I mean, see that coming of age of the local or the vernacular, and where, so based on a conscious choice that this vernacular came into being, following practices and formations ordered, encoded in what constituted cosmopolitan translocalism. So the cosmopolitan translocalism, which was basically defined by a Sanskrit acumen, one of those famous historians, Sheldon Pollock, talks about this Sanskrit acumen, and he talks about the death of Sanskrit around the second of millennium. Definitely Sanskrit didn't die. It continued survive and continues to survive. But there was a kind of very strong tendency on the part of this literati to talk in terms of local languages and try to project a kind of idea where their region, their ideas, their practices came to be very seriously emphasized, came to be very seriously acknowledged. And this, which I see as a kind of vernacular chronotope, to borrow this idea from Mikhail Bakhtin, where he says that in a vernacular chronotope, there is a plotting of the vernacular culture for the first time in the literary representation, for the first time. And that representation came to be, came to illuminate a lot of ideas, lot of cultural practices, lot of under-referred geographies into being. So this is where, for the first time, we see a transition from a literary representation to an idea of a socio-textual community and an idea of a political space. So language-boundedness led to a kind of, boundedness of in terms of politics. So language boundedness to political boundedness is something that is very interesting to see at this point of time. So it's a question of new ways of ordering society and polity. And I don't have to go to these things like when you try to become a socio-textual community and a new political order, first two, three important steps that one needs to follow is, first, you admit yourself to literary, that all the community within a particular region needs to be very clear about the kind of dialect they're speaking. Because at a time when Sanskrit is giving way to these languages, you see a kind of language continua, the different languages merged into each other. And to divide these languages and to say your preference in favor of a language becomes important. And that, from language continua to a particular language, from a unmarked dialect to a kind of standard, uniform standard, or from heterogeneous practices to a homogeneous culture, from undifferentiated time to a, conceptually defined space where the region comes in, where the locality comes in, where a kind of division takes place. So language is important here, but the conventionally, the way we have tried to explain this phenomenon by saying that, of course, culture is to be explained in terms of question of power. Culture is to be explained in terms of question of material conditions or economy. This is a trans-historical explanation that we have always, you know, subscribed to. But language, in terms of its aesthetic, language and politics in terms of the aesthetic of the place that is called Desi, has never been very seriously been agreed upon or seriously been endorsed. So that is where we need to see how these translocal codes and aesthetic forms and geocultural spaces came to be interrogated, giving way to a new imaginary. And also, it is more important to look at that this also, you know, initiates inaugurates the process of ethnicization and or tribalization. But the difference between South Asian vernacularity and West European vernacularity is very profound, in the sense that if you look at the history of development of the nations in Europe, you see that there is a connection, deeply embedded connection, which exists between tongue or language and the kind of something has to be pure, exclusion of mixture. If you have to be French, you have to be very different. If you have to be English, it have to be very different. So that kind of idea, you know, brings into mind the idea of a biology, which is very different in South Asian context, which is more of an ecology. If you look at the way, some of these idea of Kannada or idea of Malayalam or Marathi came up, you see that Kannada is understood as the land of black soil, or that Malayalam is basically the land of, what do you call, sandalwoods, the mountain of sandalwoods, or Braj is the land of Krishna, or for that Dakshini is basically the south, land of south, or for that matter Gwalior is basically the land of cowherds. So there is something to do with ecology. It's not something biology. So the language boundedness resulting in spatial boundedness and political boundedness is one of a transition, which can be seen in the realm of ecology to or something to do with the something innate with the region itself. So that makes the distinction very clear between a kind of European idea of vernacularization and South Asian vernacularization. So I'll skip this by saying that we cannot simply, the question that the point that I'm trying to harp on, the hammer on, is the idea that we cannot simply afford to look at a pre-colonial situation from a post-colonial sides, with our own conventional understanding of making sense of the past in terms of certain categories, which has been a kind of legacy of Europe, and that Europe that I'm that has been deeply questioned already for last 20 years as we do history for other regions of the globe, whether South Asia and others. And this famous decentering has taken place. So it's a question of, we need to think that when we try to make sense of South Asia as a political, as a cultural reality, then some of these categories with which we have thought about it may not be adequate and may need some more supplementations. So many people would not agree when we try to say that language in itself can be a very substantial factor in articulating idea of a polity. But if we look at critically these processes on an empirical register, that comes to mind, that gives a very clear impression that these processes cannot simply be undermined, cannot be glossed over. So language remains as a very important, crucial factor, both in real world production and theoretical engagement with issues of identity that we are now talking about, that your colloquium is trying to focus on. And I have already talked about this. The point again that I needs to be reiterated, that its spatial boundedness is not a natural fact. It's a cultural exercise. It's a cultural fact. And that also brings into mind the famous idea that was, advocated by a very important social theorist, Benedict Anderson, when he said that it's an imagined community. And here, there is a bold, Pollock makes a bold departure to Anderson's understanding that human linguistic diversity cannot be a matter of fatality. It cannot be, some kind of self-conscious decision. So languages, vernacular languages, simply do not, emerge as butterflies, something like that. It is made because of a particular historical context, and when the decision to speak locally becomes crucial, and that led to a series of changes that led to bringing in a series of changes. So I have already talked about this, that how language as a culture of place, of course, the way it has been thought about in some of these interesting works, is to be distinguished from marga, the way. The marga is the one which was defined, which was very seriously articulated upon by a Sanskrit world order. And vernacular language, by propagating a new agenda, thought of challenging this and bringing its own conceptual resources. So it's basically, as I said, but most importantly, when we try to emphasize on this fact that these expressive motifs, how does these expressive motifs of this place came to be configured? It's not a question of only supplanting or challenging a Sanskrit order, but at the same time, and also appropriating some of the, discursive styles, some of these, styles or conventions which was available in that literature, and appropriating them to the making of your own language, but at the same time, you develop your own fits and forms. So that is important. So this is how a vernacular counter comes into existence, or a new aesthetic of place comes to be, form. As I said, that the first plotting out of the domain of vernacular culture in the literature for the first time, followed by its enunciation in terms of an idea of place with a layered and nuanced domain of culture. First, the idea of the region came to be reflected in the literary text, or it came to be represented in the literature. And these ideas came to reinforce the idea of a region. So from here, drawing on these kind of ideas, I get on to this question of how Sarala Mahabharata in late 15th century inaugurated that famous moment for our own cultural identity, for our own imagination, how it constituted a language boundedness, followed by a spatial boundedness, followed by a kind of political boundedness. And of course, I'll try to show that what kind of textual strategies and thematic polarity involved. As you know, that it was basically a retelling of canonical Mahabharata with certain episodes, characters having been conceptualized differently. It, of course, offers deep insights into the contemporary socio-cultural landscapes built under different episodes and characters. But most important about this text is that it offers a shifting orientation. It evinces a kind of shifting orientations to the domain of language, community, and thematic focus, its spatial geographies. The language, the domain of language, when we see that Odia is coming up, the community in terms of lower caste are getting an entry into that whole space of literacy, and they start speaking. And as you know, that we tend to think of these lower caste poets who became, I mean, this explanation with which we have been very familiar, that this is a kind of rebellion by the lower caste. And that's how we see that Sarala and other came off to take up the cause of Odia. But beyond this, what is more important that to note is that this shifting orientation in terms of language, community, thematic focus, and spatial geographies came to expand the horizon of knowledge. And when Sarala was writing this, he was looking at a different kind of society, as he could see that its ideas, its some of these concepts with which to think through his region needs a different kind of imagination. It cannot be simply done by banking on Vyasa's idea, the kind of conceptual resources which was available to Vyasa 1,000 years back may not be very relevant to do that. Just to give some quick examples about the kind of textual strategies and thematic colors that Sarala Mahabharata involved or embodied, you see that some of the characters were told differently. And if Puru, the Pandavas were privileged in the original account, the Kauravas got a more of a more dominant share in his text. And some of the undertold characters, minor characters, becomes more important. And for that matter, some of the, he talks about geographies, underreported geographies, talks about different places, places of pilgrimage, sites of Odisha, and tries to talk about this. Most interestingly, when he says that Yudhishthira had to marry the daughter of a trader, Odia trader Harisau, it's see the kind of localization he's trying to bring in. Or when he says that if you try to reconceptualize a kind of idea which is originally embedded in a particular text, and you try to reconceptualize it after 1,000 years, you have to bring in your own imagination. The interesting point that has been made that at a point when you try to write a book and for with the idea that people would read it, you have to tailor different textual strategies. It cannot be simply the way it has been done, or it can be retold the same way. So you have to bring in very interesting ideas. So if you try to make it familiar, this some of these very difficult concepts which was there in Vyasa's text, and you try to elaborate it, enunciate it in a different form, that becomes interesting, because people would, those days it was not that is a kind of a transition which is taking place from orality to literacy or writing. So when most the audience would be listening to it, you must make sure that they will not sleep. They will not, the drowsy audience need to be woken up. So you have to bring in some of the ideas with which they are familiar. So you have to talk about Harisau, or if you have to say that somebody's mother in the Pandava lineage is a Odiani, or Shiva lived in Kapila's hill in Dhenkanar, and Arjuna met him near the neighborhood of Kapila's, where Parvati was taking out lice from the matted hair of Shiva. These are interesting ideas which are very well known. It's very interesting. I was trying to reflect on this, that in a hamlet or in a village, what we see that in winter afternoon, the mother or the daughter would be taking out, things from the hair. So he was sensitive to this. And if you try to portray this, this would be more interesting. And there are several other examples. For example, the idea of humiliation caused to Draupadi is differently told when there is an episode which is being discussed called ripening of mango. And in that incident, that all the Pandava brothers are being asked by Krishna to tell the truth, every truth brutally, that what is happening in their mind, what is going on in their mind, and including Draupadi. And Draupadi, and before the presence of a huge audience of people, like the Brahmins, what says, and in that situation, Draupadi had to tell the truth that she loves Arjuna the most. So this is something very interestingly conceived. These are deeply introspective moments of the text. Or for example, again, you see in that text a kind of, conversation between sublime and the subaltern. For example, you would say, the kind of language he's using is also interesting. You would say mutra nira. Mutra is basically to suggest urine. To use mutra in a Puranic text would look very awkward. So would say nira, mutra nira. Or for that matter, to talk about a nature-induced cleaning, that ablutions that we have to make, you would say prakruti sanskara. So you see a lot of innovations, a lot of experiments being taken up by him at least sanitize language, to make it more understandable to lay audience, and at the same time to bring in some of the very critical philosophical reflections of the original text by describing it in a different flavor. So that is what most important. We talk about how Arjun would collect weapons from he says Durvasa would collect weapons from Arjun near Kapila seal. Or you talk about different practices, different places, different sites of pilgrimage. And for example, you would say that the kind of culinary practices which are available in Orissa that point of time comes very clear in that text. We talk about different kind of pizzas like manda, arisa, khiri, all this kind of thing. So he was talking about the region, its ecology, its practice, its the way people think, and you are trying to also stitch some of the non-religious issues or non-religious themes into structure, the narratological structure. Yes.
अरे यार ये समुद्र गारा गारा है.
Can you just there is some noise which is coming in.
Please go ahead, sir.
Okay. So, for example, there are a couple of themes that needs also a kind of illustration. Particular themes like Duryodhan's crossing of the river blood or ripening of the mangoes, the worship of Krishna in the form of Nilamadhav are some of these motifs which is very different, which is not there. It's it marks a distinct departure from the original text. And for example, Krishna being a god will be, you know, overwhelmed with the idea of sorrow and overpowered with the idea of sorrow when Vishnu tells him that it's time now that you have to go back because your lila has to come to an end. So he is crying, saying that he has so much of attachments in this world, the worldly attachments he has to sever. That is something that Krishna is seen as a kind of human being in the world. Or Duryodhana, who is really depressed to see that, depressed to see his crying over the dead body of his son, or for example, Yudhishthira's pain to see that in the battlefield when Duryodhana is being very seriously, brutally getting injured. So this is something which is not very clearly visible in the original text, and we see this departure. And also the personhoods, like as I said, Krishna, Shakuni, and Gandhari were infused or invested with different subjectivities. Krishna crying is something of illuminates a different character. Also, the characters like Balram, Dhritarashtra, Vidura, Drona, Ashwatthama, Draupadi are very little characters like Suhani, Subhadra, Hidimbaka, Ghatotkacha. They remain privileged. Now, for example, Suhani is a character who happens to be the daughter of Harisau, the trader, and who was supposed to marry Yudhishthira. And the Pandava brothers persuaded him to marry. Otherwise, this lady would have died. So these are things that we come across. As I said, these things I have already said. So that is what is important to emphasize here in this text is that there is a nativization of the narrative, which occurs by stitching into it the local sites of pilgrimage, rivers, mountains, culinary, and other social practices, which are of lot of everyday everyday importance. So the text, what I'm trying to say, that gets tailored out as a localized version, and the original story becomes part of a collective belongingness. This is important because you are not simply supplanting the existing preceding order, the cultural practices, ideas, its conceptual resources, but you tend to believe in that this is a past that we inherited, but at the same time you are developing your local fruits and forms to come up with the idea of your own region, and you are speaking locally than globally. So this is from where I start talking about, focusing on this idea of Sarala Mahabharata. Now I want to show that how the narratological structure, the thematic collage, or the idea of space, geocultural space, which developed in that text, came to also anticipate some of the ideas of Madala Panji. As you know, that Madala Panji, which was crafted as a kind of trans-dynastic account of Odisha region in 17th century and late 16th century, is basically about the temple chronicles, talking about the history of God, Lord Jagannath, and its temples, its relations with different regions, not only coastal Orissa, but Sonpur, Sambalpur region, and also the kind of people who visited this temple and the kind of privileges that remained associated with the king to do their service. All these things can be seen from Madalapanji. Of course, Madalapanji is to be understood in terms of a kind of genealogical, the kind of temple chronicles in terms of the history of the temple, which is called Rajbhog. But at the same time, most important is the other records about the temple, which can be understood, which gives us a lot of idea about the administrative ritual and other practices associated with the temple. And these Chamu Chittas, the royal letters, talk about that. So Madalapanji is not to be only understood, it's a kind of history of the temple, but the fact that this text was not taken very seriously in its in the whole of 300-400 years till about 19th century, though this continuously the tradition came to be written and rewritten, culminating with that text called Kataka Raja Vanshavali in 19th century in 1820, and then there was a colonial censure saying that these things are not important. That somehow tried to dispel these histories from being taken into account very seriously. I'm going to talk about that in a brief while. And see that this is genealogy's property list of the temple, and this account of documenting this, the account of continuously crafting these tradition became very important soon after Kalapada's attack in 1568, because his attack was devastating, and there was a need on the part of the sacral power or the kings or the priests, because they wanted to renew the, not only they wanted to renew the cult, but also try to bring into a kind of organized system by talking about the lands of the temple and the rights over it. Everything has to be clearly pronounced. So part of that effort led to the systematic organization of systematic writing of the accounts of the temple. And also along with this, a host of traditional and legendary accounts came to be stitched into it. So one is genealogy, property list, which is secular in certain ways, and also the legendary and traditional discourses. Now, and these things came to be very seriously done right since 17th century, particularly the third ruler of Narasimha I in the 17th century, from the original Madalapanji that we saw in Mukunda Deva's time. So, and this continuous form of writing ultimately climaxed with a kind of project, which can be called, which can be roughly called as a Mackenzie project. Colonel Mackenzie was the surveyor of British India. And before that, he was the surveyor of Madras. And if you remember that Andrew Stirling wrote his famous book on statistical, historical, geographical account of Orissa in 1821. And these two people, who can be called as Orientalists, had a lot of passion about collecting histories of local areas, histories of different goddesses, histories of places, and particularly Mackenzie was known for that. You know, he was the surveyor of Madras first, and then he became the surveyor of British India in 1815. And between 1815 to 20, he started thinking of producing a very interesting text, or producing a very full scale or systematic account of the temple. And in that project, Andrew Stirling, being an administrator and also a historian, had a lot of interest, and he persuaded Mackenzie to do that. And Mackenzie, because of his vast experience of at least scanning through the archives, non-official archives of different regions of India, whether it is Madras and other places, the northern part of Odisha, he was extensively surveying these areas, and he was engaging his pandits to collect this, the Telugu pandits. And some of these Telugu pandits, you know, tried to come across very interesting accounts of Jagannath written in Telugu, and so they collected it. And that made him to take interest about Jagannath subsequently when he became the Surveyor General of India. So, unfortunately, he died in 1821, and that led to a very serious, repercussion. I'll talk about that. But what is interesting to look at is the fact that despite the fact that both Andrew Stirling, Colonel Mackenzie teamed up to think of this project, and Mackenzie, because of his association with a learned pandit of Puri, Jagannath Rajguru, tried to take his help in writing out this interesting version of the temple called Katagaraja Vansavali. And he, Andrew Stirling, used part of it for his book on that the so-called modern, arguably the modern account of Odisha in geographical, statistical and historical account of Odisha in 1821. And because he refers the sources for this book as one Sanskrit Vansavali collected from as told by this Jagannath Brahmin Pandit of Puri, which could possibly mean Jagannath Rajguru. And he also talked about Rajacharita, which is a Odia version, and that was also part of Mackenzie collection, which Andrew Stirling certainly used. But it appears that there are two, it has been substantially been proved that there are two copies of this Katagaraja Vansavali is prepared. One copy remained in original shape with Mackenzie. Then after his death was transferred to East India Company, and then it was subsequently shifted to India Office Library in London. And later on, perhaps in 1980s, that German research project under the aegis of German Research Council took interest in such collections because of their involvement with studying regional histories. And so G.C. Tripathi and Kulke edited that book. And the other version, which was a Telugu version of it, which is incomplete manuscript called Odra Desa Vansavali, which also remained at the Oriental Manuscript Library in Madras, and subsequently edited by K.C. Mishra as part of his PhD thesis. But interestingly, this, even though originally it was prepared in 1820, and in 1895, James Fleet suddenly says that these things should not be used. These are unsupported versions, and they should be expunged from the pages of history. So for nearly 150 years, these two interesting texts, which could have thrown a lot of illuminating lights on different facets of regional tradition, regional histories, the local cultures, remained out of considerations. We remained oblivious of this fact. Even the nationalist historian, the engagement, a very serious conversation with regional history started with, of course, Andrew Stirling's work from the colonial times. And the nationalist historian like K.C. Panigrahi and others also started looking at these sources as not very, robust and very, fascinating source for writing modern history. They said that if you look at Madhava Panji, then you see the varying number of names of Kesari kings. In Hunter's book, you find it 44. in some other accounts it's 65, in some account is 35. So that led him to think that the priests, the kings, and of course the coroners had a kind of conspiracy in trying to project themselves in different ways. So these are not history proper, they cannot be taken into account. So one of those most famous historians of our post-colonial times, who in fact was partly instrumental in shaping the course and career of modern history of the region, remained oblivious of these ideas. And interestingly, the other misconception that went into the making of it is that we often thought that Madara Panji means Rajbhog, the only genealogical history of this Jagannath temple and Jagannath. Beyond this, there is plethora of informations which are discerned in these administrative these reports about temple in the temple records, which gives a lot of idea about administrative ritual social practices that remain out of, because the Arthavallabhanti's book Madara Panji Rajbhog Itihas itself is a very expressivist title, which made us think that is Madara Panji is to be only thought in terms of its genealogical dimensions, keeping away the whole lot of information which can be gleaned through from its records. So this could have at least very deeply or very critically transformed our ideas of the region and sub-regions, which was not to be there. And interestingly, the whole archives of Mackenzie, which he collected these records and everything, remained within his possession. And this was, in 1938, was, transferred to Ravensa College, the academy, the Odia Academy. But these 138, manuscripts could not be subsequently located where it went. So because of, I see these moments as very disturbing, because it hounds out these voices, a world of subaltern, a world of vernacular, subjectivities out of considerations, and they're declared out of bound. Even R.P. Chand in 1926, when he tried to locate the possibility of getting that Rajacharita, Odia version of Rajacharita, he couldn't locate that. But subsequently, Arthavallabhanti wrote in 1940 on the basis of that text, account called Rajbhog Itihas. So when we try to see the biography of Mackenzie as a colonial administrator, as an Orientalist, we see that these developments also very seriously impacted on making of these vernacular histories, and they remained hounded out. So that's why Nicholas Dix, as somewhere said very interestingly, that if Mackenzie would have survived, he would have turned these things into a master narrative. And because he died in 1821, these interesting archives or these interesting series of information were reduced or marginalized into the footnotes of the new colonial knowledge. It was reduced to footnotes because he took this pain of at least being remaining drawn to the voices of the pandits of different localities. Mackenzie used his Telugu pandits, listened to them, their ideas, and made them write these accounts, and collected his developed his archives. And because of the fact that there was a colonial censure and our indifference, very visible indifference to engage with these ideas, which was part of that agenda of nationalist historiography, that remained out of contention. So this is where you produce a kind of context where India, as he very interestingly metaphorically says, that led to the production of silencing of India. Of course, my point again tries to interrogate this, that these voices do not simply get silenced out. They come back in different forms, in different ways. As we see the career of vernacular histories or histories in the vernacular right since 19th century. For example, when there was a colonial, as with Madala Panji, there was a growing colonial concern to write the histories of the temple, its practices, its rituals and everything. Similarly, it also translated into this project of colonial concern of trying to know about the land of the region through administrative census or other administrative practices, the technology of governance, the technology they used to know that this land, their people, their ideas. Also interestingly translated into the writing of history of the princely states, history of the Gurjars. And because at that point of time, the British wanted to know that these princely states need to be controlled and they need to be understood in terms of their history, culture, politics and everything, because at a point of time when nationalism was coming up in a deep way as a major force to challenge the colonial empire, at that point of time they wanted to make sure that they have a friend in the princely states, they have their support from the princely states. So they wanted to organize their administration, and part of that exercise was to write, understand and write the historical accounts of the states. And informed by this concern of colonial concern, there was also a competition among the feudatory states to write their own histories. Everybody competed, these 20 princely states competed amongst themselves. And at that point of time, that led to production of new kind of historical narratives. And in that narrative, what we see that the life world of the Thakurani is the Grama Devatas, the goddesses, the regional deities, the tutelary deities becomes important as part of their foundational histories. For example, as we know that if you look into these princely states, whether it is Banki, whether it is Bodamba, it is Ranpur, or whether it is Samaleswari or Sonpur, everywhere you see that the foundational histories are very seriously remain embedded into the cultural matrix of that particular sub-region where a tribal deity becomes important. For example, history of Dhenkanal, history of Banki, Charchika, or history of Badamba would suggest that a lower caste or a tribal woman was sacrificed by the king of that particular patron dynasty, and the sacrifice didn't go unrewarded because this lady came to be worshipped in that lion gate of this royal palaces. Everywhere you see this, whether it is Dhobei Guru in Banki or Dhenka Sabar in Dhenkanal, or for that matter, other Sabaro women in Badamba, or for that matter, the whole story associated with Mani Nageswari in Ranpur, or for that matter, if we try to see the idea of Durga, the Ashta Durga, Samaleswari, other these deities, where they came to be worshipped by the royal house, by the dynasties in a different place, in their place of origin. In every annual festival of the Dasara, that the kings would go pay deep respect to those deities at their original place, marked by a procession of a different order. Or in some of these places, the deities would be carried to the palace during the Dasara. So these are lesser minor deities. And The other ones, as we said, that the tutelary deities of Durga's stature were taken differently because the Raja has to go to their places to do the worship. Whereas on these supplementary kind of deities, they had to come to the, you know, Darbar once in a year to be worshipped by the royal order. That shows a kind of you know, idea of, you know, integrating the tribal world with the Kshatriya world, a kind of idea that this that seemed to, you know, strengthen the bonding between different you know, interior Adivasi regions with the main regions. Or but what is important is that when we try to imagine these histories, what we see that their historical accounts are a kind of, you know, code book of allegories. So much of so many ideas which comes through dreams, through legends, through different kind of you know, narrations, different kind of you know, stories. And these are at the level of myth. These are at the level of, you know, what you call some kind of beliefs, which we do not simply take it as very rational. These are allegories instead of literal or representations. These are at the realm of deep realms of memory, deep realms of legends, not in the surface of the presentations in the literature. And how do we make sense of that? And how do we make sense of this supernatural, these gods, these goddesses who came into our own being, our modern, our quotidian life all the time? But the kind of history, the master narrative of history that we do, simply do not see eye to eye with this. This is the moment that is another interesting moment in the domain of vernacular histories, because they remain they remain peripheralized in these accounts. And this authorized protocols of history, historical narrative, do not offer them space for being included, being heard. They remain excluded. One point that I would also try to look at, or to one or two instances that I would also give apart from this Thakuran, is a very interesting text, which is called a very interesting account of, you know, 1817 Paika rebellion, Firingi Kali Bharata. That account tries to talk about the history of Paika rebellion in a very interesting ways. One of these instances that it tries to highlight, where he says that in 1803, when Varune and Karune, the tutelary deities of Khurda, tried to protect the king of Khurda against the British army or the East India Company's army, because 1803, there is a Khurda war that happened. So at that point of time, it tries to say that the gods were very much protecting this land. But unfortunately, a person called Charan Patnaik betrayed Khurda by... Hello?
Please, sir.
Did you say something?
No, somebody else interrupted.
Okay. So, what did he, I mean, this, at that point of time, he said that these Varune, Karune, the tutelary deities of Khurda, were trying to protect Khurda. So, what can be done? That Charan Patnaik said that you have to kill a cow and you know, throw bullets or throw your cannonballs by dipping these cannonballs into the blood of that cow. And in that case, the deities would be, would be defiled, and the power of this king would be, would be gone, and you can very easily, have your victory. But the Thakurani said that Barune and Karune also told that this empire can still be saved if you do one thing, like you kill a pregnant Brahmin woman or a black cat, and then you can save this empire. But the Raja of Khorda said, no, this is anadharmic. It's not right to do that. I know that this land belongs to me. The British is only superficially trying to control it. It cannot go to them. But I cannot simply kill a pregnant Brahmin woman. So when social science tries to, or the anthropologists and historians try to look at this, I mean, I see this as a kind of instance, along with another famous instance that I'll talk about, is that here we do not give agency to the deities or the gods. Social science do not allow it. For example, a famous anthropologist like Akio Tanabe has tried to interpret this, saying that this legendary discourse should be seen as one where what you need to emphasize is that the colonized people had a, colonial, a cultural way of responding to this predicament. By drawing on this idea of, there is a spiritual sphere, there is a material sphere. In the spiritual sphere, people felt that the colonized always felt that they're important, they're significant entities. So they need to value their culture. They cannot kill like this, the way British is doing it. So that tend to see a kind of rational explanation for all these kind of activities. So, but the most disturbing or most, something which remains silenced out is the fact that we don't try to give these, gods, deities, its agency. If they believe so, if people at a particular point of time believe so, that is not taken as a kind of a narration principle which can be rationally, which can be defended in modern public life. Because again, subaltern past do not allow the historians, or do not give the historians, a certain standard rational principles which can be defended democratically, which can be defended in the modern public life. And these two, rational cogestion is important because it's deeply connected with the idea of social justice and modern public life. And history is the site, this is the site from which we do history. So vernacular in its own in its own ways of expressions, in its own ways of articulations, tend to challenge this history. And they do not always remain in a kind of very intimate manner. They challenge it. Here is the question of history too, and which do not necessarily work on to produce the history of capital, a modern consciousness. But at the same time, these supernatural, these gods and goddesses come to the of the past, come to the present, come to the our modern consciousness all the time. So this is a very interesting kind of bonding that you see, that subaltern past remain as signpost, as borders where they divide, and to the extent that they also connect. So to understand historical time as godless, as homogeneous, as something, as a linear, is always problematic. We live in heterogeneous time. We have as we have seen that, even the famous example remains that despite the fact that we are Quranic and Puranic in principles, but when you do social science, we tend to see as a universal human being, who is devoid of these kind of elements. So this is a problem with our kind of framework that we follow to understand history, it cannot possibly do justice to a whole world of voices, whole world of subjectivities, whole world of agencies, including non-human, which would be problematic. And coming to two more quick examples. In one is Kali Bhagavat is another counterfactual narrative, which talks about Kali Bhagavat, which was authored in 1934, is a kind of text which tried to, by Abhiram Paramahansa, which tried to predict the unfolding events of India. He says that in 1939, of course, these are in a very coded language. As I said, these are a code book of allegories, you know, this counterfactual narrative. Kali Bhagavat talked about the unfolding of events in saying that because there is a dominance by the British would be defeated, and the Satyagrahis under the Mahatma would fight the George V, and in 1939 they would be weak. In 1940 they cannot see, because in the 40s people develop eye problems. In 1941 there would be a kind of very serious conflict between British and India, with the cries of, you know, kill, loot and everything. Towards 1941 or 1942, this will come to an end. So someone is predicting in 1934 about the kind of events that would come in. But when we do so, I mean, we tried to justify when we did social history, we said that these materials would be very important to understand the, you know, some kind of, you know, dimensions of regional histories. But we understood social history as part of that social science, but without this very clear admission or clear acknowledgement of the fact that some of the ideas which rest upon giving agency to non-human was not there. And this point has been very seriously explained from the beginning. If you come across this example of 1855, Kanu Sidhu rebellion, where the judge asks Sidhu that, why did you rebel? He says that, no, because my Thakur said. Now, for any democratic-minded historians or for subaltern historians, that subaltern has to enjoy an agency. He is the maker of his history. He is the subject of history. But here in this case, even though Sidhu says that it is this Thakur, it is the God which came in the dream and made him rebel against the British, the democratic-minded historians do not give agency to this. So this is a problem here. How do we resolve this? So the idea of vernacular histories has to be, you know, engaged with, or has to be negotiated in its own terms. It has its own subjectivities. It has its own momentum. It has its own speed. It has its own reflections. And because of the fact that we have been tuned with a master code of narrative of history, we do not do justice to that. Here, when I say that transmemoration, I basically try to listen. The alternative explanatory trope could be to be very sensitive, to remain oriented into, drawn into these voices as the other, as the otherizations. But the final point before I close in a couple of minutes that I would try to say that how do we do we see the vernacular histories in its reaction, in its response to the master code of narrative, master code of history one? And if it is at the when it's when the vernacular history is try to translate itself into that profound world, the canonical world of history. It tries to, with all enthusiasm, it tried to be translated, but ultimately it fails. It cannot be translated because the serious historians would allow them a space till a particular point. Then they would try to explain them. Then this is the belief of a particular community of people. This is something to do with anthropologizing or to trying to talk about specific individual beliefs, which do not have any significant element of acceptance in the very imperious discourse of history. It's a problem. So it promises, vernacular history promises full translatability, but it ultimately founders and gets aborted. But when pushed to a kind of exchange, when pushed to a kind of translation, what it would try to do? It would try to be translated to the extent that the master narrative, the history, is prepared or remains oriented to be shortchanged or to be cheated. If we try to allow them to come in as a kind of very, fascinating voices, fascinating range of ideas to enrich our own historical understanding, to enrich or enliven the pluralities of past, the heterogeneous past, or the past that simply do not logically work on to produce the life processes of capital. Feudalism has to be, has to go before capitalism takes place. If we follow this particular linear sort of historical notion, then we tend to at least keep these past away. These past keep coming to us again and again. We need to open up by trying to bring them in, by remaining sensitive to their voices in certain ways and the other. So this is what I try to, this is how I try to see the career of the subaltern or the career of the vernacular in the ways it has come up by illustrating some examples from Odissean materials. And one of the things that made me think of this kind of project like this is basically the silencing, which has already occurred in some of the textbooks when they started talking about histories in the vernacular, like Partha Chatterjee's book, which came up in 2010, or before that also, the three interesting accounts of trying to spell out the agenda, the thrust, the issues concerning new cultural history of South Asia and India in very salient distinction from the cultural history the way it is talked about in Europe. We didn't find any kind of presence there. There was no piece on Odisha. And despite the fact that critical conversation on the history of the region has really taken place right since colonial times, saved, profoundly by the nationalist historiography and Marxist historiography, still then we have never been oriented to that. ORP, Odisha Research Project, in its two legs, in its two runs, one in the 70s and one in the late 90s, tried to talk about sub-regional identities, tried to open up these questions. But again, they remained within that, authorized conventions of doing history within the framework of social science, where we simply do not decenter some of our very, robustly, shaped ideas, like the question of political modernity, or the abstract notion of universal human being, or the abstract notion of the historical time. These things have never been contested, never been put into interrogation. When we try to look into the historical collage or the past of South Asia. By adopting some of these concepts, which might be very challenging, but at the same time, it could be held as, you know, something, I mean, it's a very usual conventional way of, you know, rejecting such kind of intervention, saying that, you know, this is, then you bring in this idea of, you know, religion, bring in this idea.
Sorry for interrupting. Yeah. Can you stop so that we can take up certain questions so that these also come up?
Absolutely, I'll do that. Sorry about this. So the final point that I have said is that, in defending a claim for the local, regional, popular, quotidian, everyday, we need to decenter our own conceptual, the kind of conceptual imaginary through which we have operated, and where, and I'm deeply grateful to Professor, Sahu's initial talk and subsequently followed by Professor Mahapatra Stats. But the first thing that has been emphasized, that it's not regionalist history of the region, but when we do history of region, then we need to also bring into critical scrutiny about the categories with which we do history of region. Secondly, as Professor Mahapatra said, that concepts and categories, as a life world, it gets exhausted. And the ways we have done it, these are the kind of ideas which may not simply remain explainable within the codified world of social sciences. Thank you very much, Uma, for these things. I am sorry for not being very
good. Thank you.
Of course, as usual, there's a problem with my articulations all the time. But I think some of the comments would make me enlightened on more on this.
Thank you. It's a wonderful lecture and a plea to reimagine the kind of narratives we need to spin around the process of understanding the configuration of region. No, and it's very important also to bring in these narratives, such as that of the Khilamunda, of Banki Rajavanshavali, or that of Dhinka. And there are many others, quotidian lives, quotidian examples, such as, for example, how do you look at the so-called Siddhas? How do you look at Dahani, Jogini, and others? How, for example, Nitai Dhobini, so, you know, about Chodogonga Deva and the world of magic that is talked up. These kind of narratives are as much important in our constructions as the, but there are two interventions that I want to make. These two interventions is about the rupture that the second millennium vernacularity or vernacular language brought about in the configurations or in the construction of a geophysical entity called Udradesa. Because this also continues in Sanskrit literature. For example, look at the way Kosalananda Kavya has been mapped out, or Kapila Samhita in 13th century mapped out. You know, it created a sacred geography. The coded language, the narrative structures, and the textuality and its tonality are obviously restricted to the world of sacred, but that continues throughout, even in vernacular. Therefore, I am not sure of the kind of rupture that is talked about in Shelton Pollack's work. And I am also equally, I'm quite in tandem with your thought that, no, this is not about language. This is a creation of a geospatial entity which embeds within it culture and other things. But now, I throw open the question, throw open the session, and there are many who are raising their hands. One question that has come up is from Professor Nagaraju, our Vice Chancellor. He talks about the fate and the destiny of the Mackenzie collections are. That he wants to know, and how could it have helped us in constructing an alternative history than that has been given in conventional history like history of Odisha by Panigrahi. And then there is questions from students. You could note down these at a go so that you can answer them together. Therefore, one question is from my side. It is about the binaries that are being made or the so-called supplications that we talk of in the vernaculars, but I see a continuity of Sanskrit and the vernacular Sanskrit, the Sanskrit language that is produced in Odisha up to 16th century, continue to configure Odisha in specific ways. For example, Kapila Samhita, Kosalananda Kavya, I gave you two examples. The second issue is about the trajectory of Mackenzie collection, the narrative of Mackenzie, how far did it go? The third question that has come up is the interrelationship between vernacular language and subalternity as a prelude to liberal, multicultural, uncritical postmodernism. That is, there a linkage between vernacular languages that talk of the erasure in existing history, the subalternity that we need to bring in to the table as a prelude to a pluralistic narratological structures coming, not structure, plural narrative, multicultural, but nevertheless uncritical postmodernism. Another question that has come up is regarding the agency of persons, agency of human being in Bhakti literature, where there is a deliberate attempt on the part of the Bhakta not to talk of himself to Bhakta as a marginal person, Bhakta as a marginal persons, whereas God as the omnipotent one. So how do you look at this marginalization of Bhakta in Bhakti literature of 16th century? That has come from Krishna Kanta. Then there is a question which has come up from Alok Kumar Mallika. He has raised his hand. I'll request him to come live, but very brief, because we don't have time. We have already taken too much time. And any other questions that anybody, any distinguished participant want to raise, please come. First, Alok Mallika, please raise your questions. By muting your video, you can unmute your audio and ask the questions.
Yeah, thank you, Umab, for this.
Somebody wants to raise a question. Sir. Alok Kumar Mallik, can you hear us, sir? Okay, sir, you can go ahead.
I just wanted to know, what exactly, just towards the end, I couldn't hear, about Mackenzie collection, the project came from Professor Nagaraju, your vice chancellor, esteemed vice chancellor. What is that question? How did it...
Questions about what is the fate and the journey of Mackenzie collections after it was lost?
Yeah. So that point, I think, I hope I tried to reflect on by saying that, this very interesting archives remained out of public gaze for more than 150 years and producing, of course, as Nicholas Dick says, the silencing of India. It is only in the recent past, in the last 20, 30 years that we have started looking at it slowly. But we never know that supposing we would have, there is ifs and buts and the hypothetical situations. If these archives would have been integrated to the construction of understanding about the past, or could have been examined or evaluated by contemporary historians right since colonial period, because Andrew Stirling had written that book in 1920, and soon after that, till about 1980, we simply remained away from this. And this would have definitely made us look our own tradition more intimately, more differently than the way we are being processed as historians today in terms of doing regional history, or we said regional history, but history of region. Some of these very significant dimensions of regional history and culture remained out of very intimate conversation or very interesting dialogue that couldn't take place. So that is the point that I can immediately try to respond. Of course, the possibilities for any situation, for any historical situation could be many. It is full of possibilities. If you abort a particular strand of possibility, then it has its own run. It has its own way of transforming it to the other movement. So that is that is where we need to think of that the presence of this archives, which is non-official archive in certain ways, because it collected from pundits, would have definitely enriched our understanding. Now, coming back to quickly to your point that Pollock's idea of binaries, I think you also know this. I mean, he's very famous. In the initial spree of writing, he talked about toyed with this idea of gestures towards the idea of death of Sanskrit, but not at all. Sanskrit remains a very profound way of shaping our ways of being. Whether it is global or local. So this text called Cosmopolitan Vernacular itself is suggestive of that expression, that even though we supplanted or we supplemented, we appropriated, supplanted, and we tried to define ourselves as local, so that give and take always continued. Because till about 19th, 20th centuries, we see that all these Rajavanshavalis had a very tremendous passion of writing their text in Sanskrit. So the problem of trying to understand these dynastic histories is that you have to be a Sanskrit scholar, because this tradition of following the norms, the conceptual resources as encoded in the cosmopolitan order was very important, was deeply respected. It continued till today. So there is no death as such. These are only metaphorical expressions. So, and no situation could be possible. Similarly, when we try to, reconfigure the world of vernacular, we need to be aware of this whole imperious domain of, I called it imperious, a very hegemonizing world of history or social science, and they remain indispensable, but at the same time inadequate. This is the question of looking at something as indispensable at the same time looking at the limits of history. That the point that very clearly comes up, that vernacular history is very strongly gestures towards the limits of history, but at the same time it tries to put off a very very serious claim, a very critical claim about its unspokenness, that you need to recognize that you are not speaking in your narrative about my voices. That needs to be. So this brings into the question the limits of history and the limits of historical consciousness. That is that you need to
see. Any other questions from our participants? So there is a question from Krishna Kant. Regarding, why is it that Sarala always invoked his low caste origin, whereas Bhakti tradition is all about taking a poetic license of representing the self as marginal? And there is another question, question regarding, did Sarala Das interventions by making low community speak up, in 15th century has any relevance or has any lessons for today? Can poetry, can literature be the medium of this articulations of protest of a different identity and reconfigurations? Yeah. That's another question that has come up.
Yeah, that's a very interesting question, because you know, but as you know already, that students of history, students, when we try to tend to examine the question of identity, and you know, and when this question of identity as articulated by certain communities, whether it is low caste or whatever, they repeatedly tell about that past. And of course, as we know, that literature and literary expression becomes a new aesthetic of expressing dissent. I mean, the whole fact that the whole project or the whole positionality of speaking locally itself is a challenge to a cosmopolitan order. So, but the point that I would again try to bring in, apart from all these conventional explanation, low caste protest against a hegemonic order, beyond that, what we need to look in is the fact that the language boundedness came to be expanded because of the entry of new communities, the lower caste, the new language forms like Odia, new underreferred geographies, new characters, new events. Because the same thing was not there during Bassus' time, and things have changed. And so Sarala, in his attempt to detail this text, Mahabharata, had to employ different, had to deploy different conceptual research, different imaginaries. And as part of that overall agenda, you tend to project the communities in a different way, their own life world, their views, everything. So it's only, should not be reduced to a question of, you know, Sarala Mahabharata wrote Mahabharata because of the fact that he belonged to a community and he was feeling absolutely miserable in a context like this. There was a lot of exploitation of the Brahmins over the lower caste. This is again a problem that we need to bring into mind, that we cannot simply afford to speak about pre-colonial from a post-colonial, you know, conceptual resources that we have. The Dalit, the question of the, understanding Dalit identity with the conceptual resources has made us oriented to look at a situation like this. The point, yes. We need to be very imaginative, profoundly imaginative, where we need to imagine, instead of analytic social science, we need to bring in this aspect of understanding, you know, reflexive, or what you call reflexive understanding, where we remain oriented to different voices. So whether the question of class exploitation existed, I mean, this amounts to this question, whether class exploitation, idea of class exploitation there in the feudal, in a context like 15th century, whether the gender question was there in 15th century, we tend to explain these things in a certain ways. So, a kind of alternative theoretical interventions, you know, based around post-colonial perspective, tend to interrogate these questions while agreeing to the fact that the explanatory tropes that we have are absolutely indispensable. We are not decentering the intellectual traditions, which has been a legacy of Europe. It's a robust traditions, but we need to also question it, see its inadequacies. That's important. So a lot of works on magic, on religion, on understanding, prophecy have come up. And to come back to a very famous, I really remain very deeply friendly to this insight of Legoff, when he says that supernatural overflows into the world in many ways. The supernatural always overflows into our everyday existence in a way. So so this is again a question of agency. And also, as Krishnakant asked about the idea of agency of the bhaktas, I think how do we look at this question of bhakti in a context like this demands a different engagement. But the final points, somewhere I saw in the chat box a question coming. So this idea of desi, to come back, somewhere I saw this. So it's interesting to look at this desi turned into swadeshi in the context of 19th century nationalism. Somewhere this linkage has to be also explained. As someone perhaps asked this question, the connection between desi and swadeshi needs to be understood. I think we need to think more clearly on this. As I said, Krishnakanta's question on how do we figure out the idea of devotion, idea of bhakti in a context like this is to be not to be seen as one based on the kind of understanding that we have drawn from our existing conceptual resources. It is to go beyond that and see something different.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. This may be...
Yes.
The limit of our imagination, sir. The conceptual categories that we have deployed is deeply problematic. There are many shortcomings, and your presentation today made us to think differently and also try to construct social realities that exist. Hello?
Yes, please.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, audience and participants. We are extremely grateful to you that you came and spoke for such a long time. Thank you to esteemed Vice Chancellor. Thank you to Dr. Uma Charanpati and others, and mainly many of the participants who actively participated in today's talk. Thank you so much. We are looking forward to next talk on 26th by Dr. Manu Devadevan. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
If Professor esteemed Vice Chancellor is present, may I request him to make a formal announcement of closure of this session. If not, we are...
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Professor Nanda. You raised more questions, though, always, and accompanied by explanations, but I think it would be very interesting to have one or two more lectures on the idea of desi giving into swadeshi and the subalternity, the way it has... The kind of trajectory it has taken. These are certain things probably it would be useful for the scholars of history, particularly the research scholars of history, if we can perhaps, explore those couple of ideas that you have floated in this talk. I think, let me not delay the closure. I think Dr. Mishra will pursue this. Thanks all of you, and I think the talk comes to a close. Thank you.